The Conviction of Timothy Evans. At about 9:30 p.m., Evans was escorted into Ladbroke Grove Police Station to face a grueling night of questioning and make the statements that hanged him. And the police have been accused, as is now almost invariably the case, of bending the rules and putting pressure on him to confess. So it is pleasant to report that they made no immediate effort to trap him into incriminating lies. They did not press him about Beryl and Geraldine's supposed presence in Brighton or Bristol, only to pounce with a, "Ha-ha, sonny boy, we know better than that." They told him outright, and without beating about the bush, that they had found Beryl's and Geraldine's bodies, that they had been strangled, and that they suspected Tim of murdering them. And under the shock of this revelation, Timothy John Evans very quickly confessed. He had not been in the station half an hour before he made a brief statement saying that he and Beryl had quarrelled increasingly over the debts she ran up and her bad household management. And on November the 8th, he strangled her. 2 days later, he strangled Geraldine and hid the bodies in the washhouse. There followed a much longer and more detailed statement. Chief Inspector Jennings and Inspector Black conducted the questioning, and they followed the traditional nice interviewer, nasty interviewer double act that had proved successful in wartime interrogations. Inspector Black was nice, the sympathetic questioner, who seemed to be on Evans's side, and without saying so, suggested to the little man that he would protect him from Jennings. Inspector Black, Evans later told his mother, was a real gentleman. Chief Inspector Jennings was the nasty questioner, openly hostile, openly disbelieving almost anything Evans said, angrily insisting that the police knew all about what he'd done anyway. It was Jennings who unwittingly caused Evans to fear that the police would take him downstairs and duff him up in the basement if he didn't say what they wanted. No one has ever claimed that any actual threat was made. It was all in Evans's mind. But the fear was genuine, and it arose from Jennings' aggressive questioning. Like Black, Jennings was a much bigger man than Evans. Unlike Black, he didn't have to conceal his distaste for the stupid little vulgarian liar confronting them. For Jennings and Black certainly both disliked Evans. They had seen Geraldine's body. Whatever household dispute might have led him to lose his temper with Beryl, there could be no respect for a man who had tied his tie round the neck of a sweet little baby girl and drawn it so tight that the cloth disappeared under the flesh, while the child convulsed, turned purple, and died under the fierce strain of her father's hands pulling the ligament. They didn't need to ask Evans the motive for killing his daughter. It was obvious. To save his own skin. He'd killed his wife in a quarrel and hidden the body. Now he was left with a crying baby to tend while he went about his daily work. He couldn't give Geraldine to anyone else to look after without inviting questions about Beryl's whereabouts. Easier and safer to kill the baby, too, and tell everyone that mother and child had both gone away on holiday. Later, it could be said that Beryl had deserted him and taken Geraldine with her. Jennings and Black felt inevitable loathing for a man who could do that to his own innocent infant. So they coaxed and wheedled and bluffed and bullied a full confession out of him. A statement that could be taken into court and shown to match all the known facts and secure a conviction and the gallows for this sordid little liar and slayer. And Evans gave them a full account of the events leading to the murders and the murders themselves. He told about the furious quarrels over money. While he handed over most of his weekly pay packet to Beryl for housekeeping, just keeping a couple of quid drinking money for himself, she ran up quite unnecessary debts. When he found what she owed, he borrowed the sum from his governor at the Continental Wine Stores off Edgware Road and was sacked when it was found he'd asked for it under false pretences. He was lucky he could go back to his old job at Lancaster Food Products. Of the £6 or £7 a week he earned, £5 was, by arrangement, given directly to Beryl, who would collect it from the firm. So Tim was furious when he found Beryl had fallen behind on the hire purchase payments and lied to him about it, angrier still when he found she'd let the rent fall into arrears. They quarrelled, sometimes violently, with Beryl threatening to walk out and go to her father at one point. Until, on the evening of Tuesday, November the 8th, they hit each other, and Evans picked up a piece of rope he'd brought home in the van and strangled her. He wrapped the body in the blanket and green tablecloth in which it was found, corded it up, and put it in Mr. Kitchener's empty back room on the first floor. In the small hours of the morning, he took it downstairs to the wash-house, put it under the sink, and concealed it with pieces of timber that were being stored there. He went to work as usual the following day, feeding and changing Geraldine before leaving and on returning, and trusting she would be all right left in her cot. He did the same thing on Thursday morning, but when he asked his governor at Lancaster Food Products for wages in advance and told him Beryl had gone to Bristol, he was sacked on the spot. So when he came home, he strangled Geraldine, and later that night, when the Christies had gone to bed, he took the child down to the wash-house and hid her body behind the door, which he then locked carefully. On Friday the 11th, he arranged to sell his furniture to Mr. Hookway in Portobello Road. The van came to collect it on Monday the 14th, and Evans took the night train to Wales, turning up on Mr. and Mrs. Lynch on the morning of Tuesday the 15th. Now, it has been objected that Jennings and Black fed Evans material parts of this statement, and they did not deny it. They had indeed told Evans Beryl had been found under the sink, hidden behind pieces of timber, and Geraldine had been found behind the door. They had indeed told him that Beryl had been strangled with what seemed from the marks on her neck to be a piece of rope, and Geraldine had been strangled with a tie. They had told him that Beryl's body was wrapped in a blanket and a tablecloth. And Evans confirmed that the rope was his rope, the tie was his tie, the tablecloth was his tablecloth. But why shouldn't Jennings and Black have sought precise detail and information about these things? They hadn't picked up a vague suspect after finding a pair of bodies. Evans had himself gone to the police with a cock-and-bull story about putting his wife down a drain, changed it to a set of extraordinary panic accusations about his neighbour carrying out an abortion that went wrong and sending his daughter to East Acton to be cared for by a childless young couple, and finally confessed that he had murdered both wife and daughter very soon after being told that they'd been found strangled and he was the obvious suspect. Evans had run himself into the charge room entirely voluntarily before anybody knew there were any bodies anywhere. Why should anyone with an atom of common sense imagine that anybody else had anything to do with it? His balmy allegations about Christie were obviously groundless. Christie wasn't an abortionist, wouldn't have known how to carry out an abortion if he wanted to, and said, obviously truthfully, that he had never aborted anyone in his life. This wasn't an interrogation to trap Evans into revealing the truth. It was part of the investigation to get him to explain why and how he had done what the police already knew perfectly well he had done. And so they were within their rights in filling in details and asking him about them. His responsibility for the crimes wasn't in question, least of all by himself. The only thing for which Jennings and Black may be criticised is their insistence that they stuck rigidly to judges' rules, that Evans's statement was made all in one piece, without interruption or intercalated questions, and that it was all complete, read back to him and signed before midnight. That's manifest rubbish. The statement is too long and too detailed for a man of Evans's inarticulacy to have made it without any prompting. It contains words and phrases that are obvious copperese, as is normal in any statement made by a semi-literate villain whose stumbling remarks and answers need editing before they can be presented in sensible form to a jury. There's nothing wicked about police interviewers putting the accurate gist of a suspect's confession into comprehensible and ordered form before he reads it and signs it as a correct statement of what he says he did. Unfortunately, some judges and many law reformers live in a cloud cuckoo land wherein crimes can be solved if illiterate and mendacious school leavers are allowed to make fragmentary utterances for presentation to uncomprehending juries. I'm perfectly certain Jennings and Black kept Evans up half the night to get his statement together and in shape, and I think it was right that they did so. Wrong, if understandable, that they later said they hadn't. The following day, Evans was taken to the magistrates to be charged with murder. On the way, he made a small additional confession to Inspector Black. He had taken Beryl's wedding ring off the body and sold it in Merthyr for 6 shillings. With the magistrate's proceedings over, he was taken to Brixton Prison and given a formal medical examination. He gave Dr. Matheson, the medical officer, details of his background and education, then repeated his confession to the murders, substantially as he'd given it to Jennings and Black. The next day, Sunday, December the 4th, brought him his first visitor in prison. Mrs. Penry Probert, his mother, came to see him. Her anger at his disappearance, leaving debts behind him, was now quite overwhelmed by the shock and distress of this utterly unanticipated crime. "Tim," she said, "why did you do it?" And she received an utterly unexpected and astonishing answer. "I didn't do it, ma'am," said Timothy John Evans. "Christy done it. Ask him to come and see me. He's the only one who can help me now." In fact, the police went to see Christy first. They re-interviewed him and Mrs. Christie on Monday, eliciting very little of importance. Mrs. Christie said she'd been in and out of the washhouse repeatedly while the bodies were there, never suspecting their presence. This seemed possible, despite the tiny size of the structure, because it was unheated, and in the extremely cold weather, Beryl and Geraldine were almost perfectly refrigerated. There was no smell of decomposition to attract attention, and the pathologist was able to make a much fuller autopsy than might have been expected, given two-week-old corpses. Christie's most important remark was that he hadn't been in the washhouse much himself, but he did notice on the morning of the 14th of November, the day Evans left for Wales, that the timber there had been stacked neatly in front of the sink. Looking for corroborative evidence for Evans's statement, the police found several people who'd been in and out of 10 Rillington Place between the 7th and the 14th of November. On a date she remembered as Monday the 7th, Mrs. Christie said Beryl was visited by a girlfriend called Joan Vincent, who came by two or three times a week for a chat. Mrs. Vincent confirmed the visit and remarked that it had been odd. The front door was open, which she'd never found before. Usually Christie, the ground floor tenant, helpfully went to the door and admitted callers, asking their business before directing them on to one of the upper flats. Equally oddly, when she went up to Beryl's flat, the kitchen door on the upstairs landing was closed, something she'd never found before. Beryl did not answer her knock and call, and when she tried to open the door, she had the distinct impression that someone was standing behind it, deliberately holding it to. Mrs. Vincent went away puzzled without seeing her friend. Before she left, she asked Mrs. Christie if Beryl was out, but Mrs. Christie didn't know. Joan Vincent was still more taken aback when she called round a day or so later, and Christie met her at the door. He told her Beryl was not in, and it would be better if Joan stopped calling on her, as her clothes were better than Beryl's, and the jealousy this caused provoked marital discord between the Evanses. This didn't seem impossible by any stretch of the imagination. The Evanses, Beryl especially, were very young, and at least one of her girlfriends had been at the centre of serious friction in August. 17-year-old Lucy Endicott was involved in a boiling row between Evans, Beryl and Mrs. Probert, in which all four found themselves physically fighting. The upshot was that Evans left with Lucy, declaring he would never see Beryl again, only to return with his tail between his legs the next day, after Lucy had decided that one night of the little man was all she could stand. All things considered, Mrs. Vincent's evidence seemed irrelevant. But there was another group who had been busy in Rillington Place at the time of the murders. The washhouse, the ground floor passage flooring, and the window of Christie's sitting room were all undergoing structural repairs ordered by the landlord. And workmen from Messrs. Larter's building firm were in and out from November the 1st to November the 14th. And their initial evidence was staggering. They had repaired the washhouse roof and lime-washed the walls and ceiling. They had stored their tools there, and finally they had cleared and emptied it on completing their work. Two of them had carried out the final work on the washhouse ceiling on the 9th of November, the day after Beryl's murder, with her body hidden in the room. They kept their tools in there for the next 2 days, and finally cleared them out on Friday and removed the wooden shores they'd used for repairing the roof. And they were quite sure there were no bodies in the washhouse then, for they cleaned it thoroughly before leaving. Yet Evans had confessed to hiding Beryl there the previous Tuesday night, and Geraldine the night before. Odder still, a third workman, a carpenter, had supplied the pieces of timber which were used to hide Beryl's body. They were pieces of rotten flooring ripped up from the passageway, and he gave them to Christie as firewood when he finished the work. But he didn't rip them up until Friday the 11th, and he didn't hand them over to Christie until Monday the 14th, the day Evans saw his furniture removed and went to Wales. No wonder the police looked at these statements, scratched their heads, and recalled the workman with the observation, "Your statements don't quite fit Inspector Jennings' calculations." Let's not make too much of this. It's perfectly common for witnesses to remember times and dates inaccurately, especially when looking back a month or more. The timesheets of the two men who had been in the wash house didn't prove anything except that they finished lime-washing the ceiling after Beryl's body had been put there by Evans. And after a good deal of pressure, they agreed that they probably wouldn't have looked down at the floor while attending to the ceiling. And it was possible they'd carried out the thorough cleaning of the room previously and just taken the tools out at the end of the week. Their statements were arguably in order. The carpenter's was a little more problematic, and oddly, his timesheet is the only one of Messrs. Larter's to have disappeared in a 15-year period covering the murder dates. Larter's say they sent it to the police and it was not returned with the others. The police say they never received it. Eventually, this problem was resolved. Christie recalled seeing two large planks outside the house while the work was going on, the residue of which became timber that was left behind. The workman who had done the wash house recalled that some old flooring was given to the tenants before they left. The confusion of misrecollection seemed cleared up, and the prosecution could proceed. The defence had a more difficult problem. Legal aid granted Evans an elderly solicitor who agreed with his 80-year-old clerk that their client was obviously guilty. Both saw the only possible defence as temporary insanity and the quarrels over money. Neither thought it could save Evans from the gallows, as Geraldine was killed 2 days later. Both professionally deplored the fact that their client insisted on reverting to his wild story about Christie's bungled abortion killing Beryl and Geraldine's disappearing after Christie promised to give her to the young couple in East Acton. Both Evans' geriatric solicitors and his golden-voiced counsel, Mr. Malcolm Morris, went to trial very unhappy that their client insisted on a defence accusing Christie of the murders, but Mr. Morris did his best with it. In the event it proved as hopeless as they'd anticipated, John Reginald Halliday Christie made an excellent impression in the witness box. He was 5'8" tall, with a domed bald head surrounded by gingery hair. Clerk-like, he wore round, horn-rimmed glasses. His suit was neat and clean, and he was allowed to sit down to give evidence because of his poor health. He suffered from recurrent enteritis, general tummy upsets, and chronic fibrositis. His voice was very soft and often sank to a whisper. This was the result of mustard gas in the First World War, which had also temporarily blinded him. So he was a brave old soldier, and in the Second War he had also done his bit as a reserve policeman. All this came out in evidence. Evans's story was manifestly ridiculous. Christie had no medical experience and had never claimed any. St. John's Ambulance first aid certificates wouldn't show him how to perform an abortion. He didn't know any young couple in East Acton. He couldn't possibly have helped Evans carry a body downstairs on the 8th of November. He was so crippled with fibrositis that week that he had to go on his hands and knees to pick up anything he dropped on the floor. Mr. Morris only put one thing to him that stopped him in his tracks. Evans said Christie had shown him medical books with diagrams of the human body when offering to abort Beryl. All right. Christie didn't own any medical books and said he'd never shown Evans anything of the kind. But he did own St. John's Ambulance books with illustrations of the kind Evans described. Now, how could Evans have known of any such thing unless Christie had shown it to the little illiterate? Christie couldn't answer that. But he didn't have to. As prosecuting counsel Christmas Humphreys immediately pointed out, the question was improperly asking him to speculate, not repeat something of which he had certain knowledge. The question disappeared unanswered. Mr. Morris's attempt to blunt Christie's standing with his criminal record backfired. As the defence had only learned as the trial was about to begin, Reg Christie was not the blameless ex-policeman he appeared. He had several convictions for larceny and one for hitting a prostitute with a cricket bat. But his last conviction had been 17 years earlier, and Christie had gone straight ever since. It seemed cruel to dredge up a decent man's shady past that he'd put behind him. Evans, by contrast, was a hopeless witness. By his own account, he had lied 3 times in signed statements and once to Dr. Matheson. Only one of the 5 accounts he had given was, he claimed the truth, the one that fortuitously exonerated him and blamed Christie. He went on and on about an abortion, but pathologist Dr. Donald Tear categorically said that no attempt had been made to abort Beryl. There was indeed a bruise inside her vagina, as though someone had tried to force intercourse with her, but the defence itself didn't want Evans accused of ravishing his wife while he killed her. Since Christie had evidently not aborted Beryl, why on earth should he have wanted to kill her? Neither Evans nor anyone on the defence team could imagine any possible motive. Evans had come forward, blamed someone else for Beryl's accidental death, confessed to the murders, reverted to blaming the someone else for the murders. Who could trust such a man? Who could believe his claim that he confessed falsely because he was upset? The jury found him guilty in 40 minutes flat. Christie, sitting in court, burst into tears as the death sentence was pronounced, and won much sympathy. Evans went meekly to the gallows, still protesting his innocence, but nobody except his mother and sister believed him. It was a trivial, sordid, domestic, open-and-shut case. I've only seen it mentioned in 1 true crime book prior to 1953. And nobody imagined for one moment that shabby little number 10 Rillington Place would make any further appearance in the annals of crime. Thank you.